come on. You're going to miss your plane.
Coming. Hi. I'm Joel Gray. Was that fun? Something I've always dreamed about. Conducting the ninth at the Kennedy Center. You know, whether I'm performing or attending a concert here, I'm always struck by the importance of sound. And this great building, with its surrounding halls, they were designed specifically to heighten the power and beauty of sound.
Joel!
Coming. As a matter of fact, all the materials that went into the construction of the Kennedy Center were chosen especially for their acoustic characteristics. The seats, the carpeting, even the crystal chandeliers were specifically designed to meet the highest standards of frequency response and sound diffusion.
Your ticket to San Francisco.
This extreme focus on sound is just one indication that the existence of our culture depends on the existence of sound. Whether it be the sound of my voice, symphony orchestra, or noise. Another indication that sound is an essential part of our lives, no matter who we are, where we are, or what we do. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye. Nice show,
Mr. Gray.
See you next Tuesday.
Okay.
The very quality of our lives depends so much upon the phenomenon of sound and our ability to hear. Sound can be played with in ways we never thought possible. We can equalize it, mix it, squeeze it, digitize it. We can drive it to higher peaks of intensity, greater levels of quality than ever before. While you listen to all this, a process far more complicated is going on inside your head. And that's the process of hearing. People, too, come equipped with a sound system. An integrated set of components which is far more wondrous and actually much more sophisticated than all this equipment. What's wrong?
Hang on. Could we hear that high register one more time, please?
Does that sound right to you?
No, it doesn't.
Yeah, it's out of tune.
Sounds off.
Sounds off.
How long would it take us to get the piano tuned?
I don't know. I think I have a call.
Could you get us a score?
It's B. B above middle C.
Good time.
Can we take a break?
Yeah.
For about an hour?
No problem.
Could you,
while you're out, go pick us up some sushi, okay? Hang on one sec. We're gonna.
But only recently have we really begun to understand the process of hearing. George, it's on me. Today, we still know far more about how we see than we do about how we hear. Why is it we know so little about something so important? Maybe it's because we take sound for granted. Until we lose our ability to hear, that's when we really discover the magic and importance of sound. You see, sound is what helps you stay in touch with the world. Your sense of hearing is what keeps you tuned to the music of life. You see, the ear is a bridge between us and the world, delivering a constant stream of sound messages to the brain. And isn't it ironic that we seldom give even a passing thought to the multitude of sounds that structure our lives day after day? The sounds of our world, they've always been important to our lives, especially in the beginning. Primitive man depended on sound for survival. You know, the ear is your best warning device. To primitive man, the ability to hear was a prime requisite for survival.
Watch it, tiger.
Obviously, it still is.
For primitive man, sound was far more important than sight. Both his predators and his prey could be heard long before they could be seen. Sound meant survival. And just as the landscape has changed dramatically since then, so has the soundscape. The soundscape is the sonic environment of an area. It's made up of events heard rather than seen. With the tremendous racket of the Industrial Revolution in full swing, the sound of the modern world was here to stay. The shriek and clatter of machines is still the keynote of our soundscape. We've always kept things to look at and remind us, remembrances of things past, the records of our lives. But before the late 1800s, it was never possible for us to listen to the past. Sound was always a thing of the present. And so our ancestors, who were hard of hearing, used ingenious devices to help them hear that fleeting moment of sound better. Ironically, it was a hearing-impaired person that gave us the ability to record and preserve sound, to capture it. And it's been capturing us ever since. But take a look at this guy over here. Strange looking, huh? But it was a machine quite like this that produced the first sound that started it all.
Mary had a little lamb, its fleece was white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go.
Edison's first phonograph was a very scratchy beginning for our fascination with sound technology. For the first time, the sounds of the past and present could be preserved for the future. At this moment, the spacecraft Voyager is carrying the sounds of our world into deep space. A golden disc, etched with the sounds of Earth and human voices, perhaps to be heard one day by extraterrestrial ears. So, what exactly is sound? I mean, we know it's everywhere. What we hear in the brook, in the wind. The noise of movement. Or is sound just a sensation for what we feel? Our label for that feeling.
For centuries, scholars have argued if a tree falls in the forest and there's no one there to hear it, does it make a sound? Some would argue, of course. I mean, sound is a physical phenomenon. It exists. I mean, whether or not there's anyone there to hear it. Now, others say sound is a sensation. It requires someone to be there to hear it, to sense it. It's up to you. Is it going to make a sound or not? Well, there really is no argument because there's no wrong answer. In one view, we're talking about the production of sound, and in the other, we're speaking of the perception of sound. One is cause, the other, effect. Both belong in the definition of the word sound. How is sound created? The first requirement is a vibrating object. Vocal cords, a slam door, or a tuning fork. The second requirement is a medium to transmit the effects of vibrations. If we slow down the vibration of the tuning fork, we can see exactly how sound is produced. The medium could be a liquid or a solid, but mostly the sounds we hear are transmitted by the medium of air molecules. As the object vibrates, it pushes repeatedly on the molecules that surround it. Those molecules jostle their neighbors, starting a chain reaction, which courses through the medium as waves of pressure or sound waves like ripples across a pond. With the oscilloscope, we can see a visual representation of a sound wave. Two important characteristics of sound waves are intensity and frequency. The height of the sound wave, from the peak to the midpoint, indicates the strength or intensity of the vibrating sound source. The harder the tuning fork pushes against the molecules, the higher the intensity and the louder the sound. Frequency, or the number of vibrations per second, determines the length of the sound wave. The higher the frequency, the shorter the wave, and the higher the pitch to the ear. For instance, middle C produces about 260 vibrations per second. A higher note, the A above middle C, vibrates faster, which we perceive as a higher pitch. The higher the frequency, the higher the pitch. Every object has a frequency of its own. You can hear it in the tone of this glass. What do you think that was, Keith?
Sounds like E flat.
Exactly.
That's my job.
Well, we don't have Ella Fitzgerald, but we do have this high-frequency compression driver, and hopefully enough power to effectively do the job. Now, by matching that frequency, E flat, a phenomenon known as sympathetic vibration can occur. The tone is in resonance with that glass. And if the intensity is strong enough, it should shatter. Can you give me any more power, George?
It's flat out. That's about 600 watts.
That should do it. Have you ever wondered what you're really hearing when you press a seashell against your ear? I always did. It's the sound of air molecules bouncing together. You see, we live in an ocean of sound. Its waves surround us. Sound is created by the elements of our world, just like this beach is created from the sand.
So the same physical laws which govern us govern sound. Sound will react in very specific ways depending on the environment. Let me show you. Look how sound waves can be reflected by a solid barrier. If they're reflected back to their original source, the result is an echo. Because of reflection, a band shell can amplify and direct the sound waves toward the audience. Just like visible light waves, sound waves can be bent or refracted as they pass from one medium to another or from one temperature level to another. Under certain conditions, sound can actually turn a corner. This effect is called diffraction. By using the edge of a barrier as a focal point, a new series of sound waves are generated with a level and frequency that's almost identical to the original.
How about just about?
So that's why a door that's open just slightly will let in almost as much sound as a fully open
door.
We're
trying to get a balance. Could you close the door?
Sorry. So, now we know what sound is.
Starting at 12.
How do we hear it? Actually, we don't. What we're doing is feeling it. Our ears are designed to feel the sound waves, then amplify and transmit the sensation to the brain. So your sense of hearing is really a tactile sense. The human ear. The perfect stereo receiver, housed in an area of less than 1 cubic inch. The workings of the ear is one of the most complex mysteries in all of nature. The ear is a transformer, changing the physical pressure of sound waves into distinct electrical impulses. The ear is made up of 3 components. The outer, middle, and inner ear. The visible part of the ear is the least important. It's just a catch for the sound waves. Your sense of hearing really begins with the eardrum. The sound waves strike the thin membrane of the eardrum and set it vibrating. Then the eardrum passes the vibrations onto the 3 small bones in the middle ear, the hammer, anvil, and stirrup. They work together as a lever system, amplifying the sound waves even more. The stirrup is attached to a soft membrane called the oval window, at the beginning of the inner ear called the cochlea. Inside the snail-like cochlea are 3 chambers filled with fluid. The middle chamber contains Corti's organ. As the stirrup strikes the oval window, the sound waves are transformed into waves of hydraulic pressure which course through the fluid-filled chambers. Corti's organ flexes a membrane which is covered with thousands of tiny hair bundles. Each hair bundle responds to a specific frequency and creates just the right electrical signal for that frequency. The action of the hair bundles send electrical signals up the auditory nerve to the brain. The ear is a remarkably efficient communication system.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you, ma'am.
¿Puedo servirle, por favor?
Operator.
Or do you have the number already?
To build a device that could do the job of a single ear, the phone company would need encoders, decoders, microwave transmitters, a hydraulic balance system, and switchboards of every size and description.
545.
Good morning, may I help you?
6681. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
It would need the capacity of a phone system for a city of 500,000, and would have to be compressed into a space less than the size of a quarter. How important are your ears? Well, let's take a simple task, like making a call.
If you would like to make...
Just to place this call, I'll follow a series of sound cues that tell me exactly what to do and when to do it.
telephone.
That's just one simple task. Think of all the others we do every day which require us to receive and comprehend countless sound messages. And if your hearing is out of order, you know, need servicing, these simple tasks can become very difficult. The human ear is well protected, but it can become defective in a number of ways. The eardrum can be punctured by a sharp object or torn by a very loud noise. By grafting skin from the outer ear, a new membrane can be stretched across the face of the eardrum. Among the various middle ear disorders is a condition called otosclerosis, which causes a bony growth to accumulate at the base of the stirrup, where it touches the oval window. Sound waves can't enter the cochlea, causing a severe hearing loss. This condition can be corrected with a surgical procedure called a stapedectomy. An artificial device is implanted, restoring the function of the stirrup. The most severe hearing problems, sensory neural loss, occur in the inner ear. The cochlea can be damaged by hereditary disorders, drugs, or excessive noise. High levels of sound pound away at the fragile hairs and eventually can destroy them. And when they're lost, the sounds they transmitted are lost forever. Research is now being conducted to give sound sensations to those with severe inner ear problems. An electrode is implanted in the damaged cochlea. The electrode is connected to an internal receiver.
How's that? Okay.
And an external transmitter and microphone are connected to the implant. The hearing impaired often have trouble knowing how loud they're speaking. The implant helps them sense the intensity of their own voice.
The coil's
it's good there.
Okay.
This woman has no hearing in one ear and a progressive loss in the other. In distinguishing sound, the implant can't match the sensitivity of the 7,000 hair bundles in a normal cochlea.
Five.
But for some, even a limited sense of hearing is a remarkable improvement.
Five.
You know, when you lose your hearing, what you're really losing is the ability to sense certain frequencies. You stop hearing certain parts of certain sounds. This recording console enables sound engineers to control and manipulate the various frequencies that make up the rich and beautiful sound we call music.
Setting a piano in the headphones?
By the use of a sophisticated filtering system, the engineers can eliminate a specific range of frequencies. Our ears can sense 20 cycles per second to 20,000. Our percussionist, it's producing sound at about 50 cycles per second. And the highest note on the piano is about 4,000. The sound of the human voice usually falls between the mid-range frequencies of 300 to 3,000. Losing the ability to hear these frequencies severely limits the ability to hear what's being said. I'll show you what I mean. George?
Hey, man, did you fill out your W-2s and your contracts?
I don't know.
Hey, George.
George, are we going to do the W-2s?
George.
I'm sorry. Say that again. I couldn't quite understand you.
It's my fault. I was trying to explain
contracts
something. Sorry.
W-2s, are we gonna
That's what
the
communication
records?
Is like for the hearing impaired. For them, the marvel of speech is reduced to a confusion of fragmented sounds that can create miscommunication and often misunderstanding. For the child who was born with a severe hearing loss, the earliest opportunity to learn how to communicate in every way possible is absolutely essential.
Make an H. You have to feel it. Good, Vanessa.
goes here. To look at me. Make another H. It's my turn. I'll make an H. You have to feel it. You have to feel it. Make an H. Good. What's this? Good language. Remember your H. Horse. Good. You did a good job.
Sound is how we touch each other from a distance. But even if you've lost the feeling of sound, you can still reach out to each other through the silent communication of sign language.
You know I care about you. You're the only other person I feel I can talk to, but it's not a good time right now. I'm too involved with school, work.
Too involved? Not the right time. What are you talking about? To be together? To be close to someone? Why do you look at the calendar? Just listen to your heart. What is it telling you? About me? About us?
Oh, I do feel it. It's saying that I want you. I want you to sit beside me in English class. Come on, let's go.
Steve, are you guys gonna work this out?
Yeah, I'm not very keen, but I'll see you later.
Perhaps the only real barrier to communication isn't in the ear, but in the mind. Your hearing is your most personal sense. You can focus it on a beautiful melody, shutting out everything else. Tune it in or tune it out, depending on what you want to hear and your willingness to listen.
Excuse me. I hate to bother you, but are you Joel Gray?
Yes, I am.
Oh, I thought you were. What are you doing here? Well, you're probably doing a show. Well, I'm here with my friend Debbie. We've never been here before. I suppose you haven't either. Come on, Debbie. I want you to meet somebody. Oh,
your name?
My biggest Deborah. Fan. Deborah. Are you doing the show? Yes. Oh, I bet you. Is it cabaret again? Oh,
no.
George M. Oh, no, you've done those. A new one.
Yes.
On tour. Oh, no, you've done on tour.
Please.
How do you do it all?
I really.
You know what? I suppose it's my job. Your natural ability.
Well,
yeah, I wish I had that natural ability because, well, I have to have it because I joined the Civic Theater Group and our first show is going to be cabaret. And I figure.
Who hasn't been in one of these situations? I mean, someone's talking to you, but really not listening to you. This is when you discover your ability to tune certain sounds down and raise the volume on other sounds going on nearby. This, they tell me, is called the cocktail party effect.
I've got one. Do you know the difference between sex and salad?
I don't know. I guess I missed it. I didn't get anything out of the film.
Exactly. That's the point. The film was a statement on the existential value of nothing.
It's close to the NBA season for 16 years.
But Dallas is married.
So what are you feeling like doing tonight?
I don't know. What are you feeling?
Hey, it's you.
So how long have you been separated?
Not long. How long have you been divorced?
I don't want to. Do I have any salad bowls? I have it.
Another nice thing that we're programmed to select specific sounds we really should respond to.
Excuse me, Mr. Gray. It was really nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Come on,
bye-bye.
Is that what you had in mind, Jim?
It's close, that is, but I think everything could go up a lot louder. Everything could be dominated.
Filmmakers know exactly how to manipulate our emotions. They're doing that right now. And one of the most effective ways to do it is with sound. Mixing dialogue and music and sound effects. By combining those sounds in just the right way, The same visual elements in a warm, comfortable lounge can be transformed into the makings of a nightmare.
Well, the next scene, we are going to start here with a whistle.
We have a whistle on the computer. You want to hear it?
Well, I'm happy with the production
sound.
Well,
wait, let's hear this whistle. What do you got?
David, let's hear a PM 157 take 7.
Now, do you have this on a loop or what?
It's coming out of the computer. Now, what we can do is we can make it mellower. Here it is, more brilliant.
Well, I don't know. Well, I like your whistle. I mean, I like the modulation. I think we'll go with ours.
Now, it's supposed to just overpower this next scene, right? It's overpowered.
Exit, please. Watch your step, please.
Gimme, gimme, gimme. I need some more. Gimme, gimme, gimme. Don't ask what for.
What's noise to some is music to others. The beauty of sound is definitely in the ear of the listener.
Give me, give me, give me. I need some more.
At the edge of the stage, the sound level is about equal to a commercial jet at full thrust. A recent study showed that many teenagers today have the hearing of a 60-year-old of the previous generation.
I like to, like, for all the guys who play guitars in the band, I like them to be real loud, because I can go better. I can pump more when I have all that volume behind me.
It's painful, though. It hurts your ears.
Yeah, but it hurts real good.
Music reflects the tempo of an age. So it's little wonder that this music has the melodic pattern and the beat of a machine gun. And attendance is not at all mandatory. Headphones can plug you into both the dangers and the joys of sound. But what may be good for the soul could be devastating for the ear. The sounds of life come in an infinite variety of shapes and effects. From the tranquil sounds of mother to the disturbing sounds of a distant world. In just 200 years, we've built a strong and powerful nation. But the same technology responsible for that growth has caused an alarming increase in hearing impairment among Americans in just the past two decades. The same machines that built our country are now beginning to ruin our ability to hear. But does losing your ability to hear mean that you've lost the ability to be a productive member of our society, able to pursue your goals, ambitions, your dreams? Let's look at one individual who lost his hearing, but never lost his dream. A dream which lives on in his music, Ludwig van Beethoven. Beethoven saw no reason to continue. He suffered tremendously and felt such anger at losing his most precious sense through no fault of his own. But then, in the silence of his despair, he heard a deeper sound, much more profound. The echo of the unconquerable human spirit. And through this, Beethoven overcame his loss. Yes, conquered his affliction and said, I will take fate by the throat. I will not let it overcome. Beethoven would work out his music on sketch pads that he always carried with him. When a sound came into his mind, He would hurriedly jot down the notes and then later would strengthen and combine them to form his great symphonies. But these notes were not just symbols of sounds. Beethoven wasn't just writing beautiful music. He was composing ideas. The Ninth was his last and some say his greatest work. Listening to it, we can hear what Beethoven was saying about the unconquerable human spirit. You see, he believed that a power flows through us all. And his dream for the Ninth was that it should be a signal, a sound that would reverberate throughout all of humanity, leading us to our true potential, the strength to overcome any obstacle, to indeed take fate by the throat and realize our dreams. Beethoven conducted the Ninth the first time it was performed. He was totally deaf at the time. After the second movement, Bobby Barris is just one example of how totally unimpaired the hearing impaired can be.
Your primary calibration signal, 1 kilohertz, 104 dB.
Technology may be the cause of much of our noise pollution, but it can also be the cure.
Okay, Jeff, I'm going to apply a calibration signal to microphone number one.
While a certain noise level is unavoidable, research is going on as to how to control it. By spreading frequencies, to produce a less offensive masking noise.
Okay.
By designing barriers to absorb and isolate noise.
Looks okay. Let's take out the bucket, close it up for a run.
And by eliminating the peaks and high frequencies of certain noises to try to neutralize the harmful effects on the ear.
A lot of shock noise. Let's take it.
Other research is being conducted to chart the acoustics of the ear, to learn how sounds are affected by the ear itself, and exactly what happens to the ear when a hearing aid is inserted. The results of this research will make it easier for all of us to hold on to the precious gift of sound.
Okay. Let's see.
Our culture is absolutely in love with the package, looking for just the right fashion and design to project just the right image. We dress to say something special about ourselves, but a hearing aid can help us know something about each other.
What you've got here is a loss in both ears, as you know, and the recommendation here on your chart is that you be fitted with both ears.
Correct.
Now, there are two types of hearing aids that I can show you that will fit your situation very nicely.
This is the Betty Boop here. Let me see. It's falling nicely. The back, the waist is slightly large.
It's gonna hurt? No, I don't think so. I promise not to hurt you, okay?
The waist is done.
Now the next step that we're going to do will be to put a plug in that ear.
Let's see the back, Kathy.
I have.
There you are.
I'm thinking maybe we can even go a little bit.
A fitting for a hearing aid is just as easy as being fitted for clothes. You pick the design that suits you, then it's measured and tailored.
You've seen that, but now we're going to apply it to your ear.
No matter how little a person can hear, how softly you feel the touch of sound,
now then,
there are still many ways to sense the vibrations of our world.
Loud.
Next change, Captain.
Wow,
that sounds beautiful.
Oh, that's great. All right,
thank
fine.
You.
Curtain's about to go up.
Sound. In the beginning, it helped keep us alive. And today, it enlivens our lives with culture. Sound. It's what brings us together. It's how we feel about our world and becoming a part of it. Sound. Our ears capture it, process it, and then send it straight to our minds. Sound. It's the symphony of the universe, composed by the mind and brought to you by your remarkable ability to hear.
This program was made possible by a grant from the Grace Foundation, Incorporated, and the Program Fund of the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. ¶¶